be self-confident, self-assuring, self-confident when you know who you are. Ego, which we have learned that no kuyu fasa na no kunye kuri ego ni shwa kumia kumuchi shwa vud. Ego. You know this. When you tell your husband, how I'm going to tell you. Ego, that ego of knowing who you are, you can use it in the negative or in the positive. So I want to talk about the ego image of man that he has in God. God has, and please understand this, I mean it in a wonderful way, God has a tremendous ego. And you know, when you scratch his ego, because an ego is, if you know his problem, his ego problem, the day you start to scratch his ego, tapale chwaka filokumbe. Sorry for using this word, kushishimuna. Take problem yakwe yo. If you want to happen, because I ya put in this, but let's have a kushishimuna. Let's have a fire. The party in the next week, that those women who keep their relationships, and it's also true for women as well, and men. Everyone has an ego.
Yeah.
Maybe the ego of women is smaller, but it's there. Mm. And a man who knows how to stroke that ego will remain in that relationship for a long time.
Yes, sir.
But both of you are proud that, you know, that you have a dress you want, which I'm about to apply you for. Your relationship will get weaker. Your head is wonderful. Even when you know that you're going up, just tell. You're not losing anything. Feel free to tell your wife she looks pretty. You may have issues with the way she's looking with the new hair, but just tell her you're a pretty girl. You are. Ego is there for all of us. And it's up to us to take advantage. God put it there. It's not God put it in him, madam. It's in him. So you must find out where it is. Scratch it. But I'm not disappointed on female. If you know his problem, one must have scratch but I lay a convoy and bring it. That's an attribute of God. When you worship him, when you praise him, does God need worship? Yes, he does. He needs it. Because that's how he flows. You can't move God without worship. You can't move God without praise. The moment you praise God, things begin to change in your life. Now those of us that are very proud, you cannot humble yourself before God, we have a problem. The image of God is that ego image, where if you sit here and praise him for an hour, I can assure you, if it comes from your heart, something will start to happen. Because God moves by praise. That's how you scratch the ego of God. Now, let me teach quickly before we come to make it practical today. Why do we praise God? Why do we praise God? Why do we spend time to praise God? It's because the truth of the matter is something that you didn't know. The truth of the matter is that in Revelation 4, chapter number 11, I believe, It tells us why we praise God. It's in chapter number 4 and verse 11. Just write it down and I'll read it for you. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power. Thou art worthy to receive glory and honor and power. Remember, God already has glory. God already has honor. God has already had power. So why are you repeating it? Lord, you have glory. You have honor. You have power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are created. Look at Brother Nevers for a few minutes. Why do we as creation praise God? To be honest with you, the only reason that God created man is to give God pleasure. Period. Just to feel nice. God created us for his own pleasure. That's Revelation 4:11. So that in that pleasure, he starts to feel we know. Now this is a bit difficult for you to believe. But you remember when Job was in trouble? When God put a Job Naikara in the Bible. And then the devil comes and says to God, no, God starts to provoke and says to the devil, who? To the devil. Job Naikara, that, hey, you devil, have you considered my servant Job? Job in Naikara. Bless our Job. She jumped child over chat terror. If a chip pan or kunshin shimuna, you are dead white, but mona. There's so mean that I am a job like you. I don't know the last time God posted over you. Job, have you seen my seven job? So the devil says, hey, Beneleza, let it out with the boy. If you have a pair of friends, if you have a fire, no kushin lusha, the friends of the mom shin lusha, who is going to fish a shark or a case I would took up. What a challenge. I can't do that. They volunteer the challenge. Fifunyako fiance. Ego ba funyako fiance kuri job. Aba na ba fua in fifi. If you ma fia lu ma fiance no man, if you don't ma fia isama mubiri, aba fia finished man. And on the devil, I tell him, but to call this a woman. Job, I can. That, now, if you want to pay, yet will I praise you. Though you slay me, yet I will bless your name.
Yes.
If you remember, that he started to praise God in a difficult circumstance. He starts to say, God, your God. God, your God. Election Narusa. God, your God. God, your God. When you praise God in those circumstances, heaven begins to shake. Because all of a sudden, God begins to have that little God dance of saying, watch when it's going to take. Praise me.
Yes.
We are created for his pleasure. Amen. You know what pleasure means? Nothing serious. If you don't have Nigeria, you don't have a question. If for a short time, if you don't have a question for me, I'm banking for his own pleasure. So you know that the better pleasure prelesa means the reason for which we're created is wasted. You give pleasure to yourself. And yet God created you to make him smile. For your pleasure, they were created. Revelation 4, verse 11 says. So we are created for his pleasure. And the reason I'm saying this today is that it doesn't matter what you're going through today. It doesn't matter who is against you today. It doesn't matter what has happened to your marriage today. It doesn't matter what has happened to your job today. Find time to have a Holy Ghost dance where you celebrate God in the midst of your circumstances. Give him pleasure. But you're still praising him. Because you know that you exist just for his pleasure.
Yes, sir.
That's if you give pleasure to God, then pleasure comes back to you. Then God begins to bless you, just like God, he restored. He restored Job. Job had it all, the Bible says, he had it twice as much. So why do we praise God? It's because we are created for His pleasure. That's why heaven has got the 24 elders. All of them are worshiping. Each day I watch the 24/7. Queen Mafia, holy. 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 And I know some of you are saying, but listen, initially for a salon, confident. Feeling your deficiency, confident. That's why He created you. It's like what on our partner. No. He made you so that you can transport Him to time. God created you that you can give Him pleasure.
Yes.
That's why I can tell you, those people that you become a big politician, God raises you to a position as MP, as minister, as vice president, as president. When you get there, you forget Him. He has made you that for His own pleasure.
Amen.
Did you hear what I said?
Yeah.
I remember when I went to Tanzania one time as a vice president for a SADC meeting. And as we were in that meeting, I realized that being a vice president and a pastor was something they were not used to. So the town of Dar es Salaam heard that there's a vice president who is a pastor who has come. So pastors were sending messages if I could preach in their church that Sunday. So I accepted one invitation to preach in an Assembly of God church, one of the largest Assemblies of God churches. And as I went there, just for them, but would say to you, ladies and gentlemen, he's acting the vice president. Who can also preach? Why? Pleasure goes to God. You use that position to give God the pleasure. Pleasure means that you have what you have because God gave it to you. Use it for His glory and the extension of His kingdom. Then where does God reside? Shall I say kind of quick? They say Karakui. They Karaku Kulukashiam. When you read the scriptures, God lives in specific places. The Bible says in Psalms chapter 22, verse 3, that the Lord inhabits or lives amongst the praises of His people. I want to tell you the truth because the Bible doesn't say he goes to those churches. God does not go there. Because the Bible says He inhabits the praises. He creates a tabernacle and lives there. That's what I want us to do today. Tumuite, tumuite. As you praise Him, there's something God can never resist. It is praise. And I'm coming to that in a few minutes. It's praise. So where does He live? God lives amongst the people that praise Him. How do we praise God? Psalm 69 and verse 30 says, God in His sanctuary. What does the Bible say? Magnify the Lord. The word magnify means ukukushia. Magnify means ukukushia chintu. So the Bible says magnify the Lord. Please listen to this teaching because as we start to worship Him in the next few minutes, if you don't get what I'm teaching, you may not participate in what I'm about to do. Ukukushia nesa. The Bembas are people that know how to glorify authority. Amashiwi, to our Adam Chimba. Mashiwe are putting on a mulumbanya. When I listen to the fire of Quika, Aleika. When you see that Malepe, Nawale mulumbanya. When we ne, at where I catch up, Guamlem Band. Now, it sounds a small thing, but in your mind, you have a picture of God who can harm the world without impanda. Nani mwe shikulu, winda pange chalo chaini no kwa ule mpande. Lelo ni mwe. Mwitwapa kakala, na mufiko se shani imamula sofa. Eko mabeoti. Na mufiko se shani, baya wamula sofa. When you praise him like that, he cannot fail. Because you describe him for who he is. So, when you magnify him and sing praises unto him, you create an environment for him to work. This is what the ego is. The ego means you scratch God where he responds to you. Now, let's talk about some examples of a man. We've talked about what God does. We talk about why we have to praise him. We've talked about where does God live. We talk about how should we praise him. Now let's talk about the man's response to praise. He comes down. Children to their parents. I have a son, my third born son, Yehoshua. He was very different when he was growing up from all his brothers and sisters. My son, for some reason, believed that there's nothing his father could fail to do. In his little mind, he thought his father was Superman. I'm serious. You know, when your father never fell with you, if you want your shoes, he goes and brings it. Without you telling him. He was so preoccupied with his father that I couldn't hold back anything from him. And then one day I would take him in the car, and he always stood, not sat, between his mother and myself. No, and I'm driving. He sat there for one reason. Somehow he believed his father was Superman. And you know, during those days, it was not common to have a Mercedes as a pastor. And I had the first one in Kitu as a pastor. So my son was into cars. So he would sit here and I would drive. And then, as a pastor, you don't drive fast so that you don't create a crisis. So the Toyotas are passing, you know, the Datsuns are passing, and my son begins to mutter into my ears. Yeah, Peter Toyota, there he goes. So I'm wondering, where is he going with this? Oh, the Datsun Kachila. Kachila Benz. And I knew exactly what my son wanted. He says, then he says, but if daddy wants, he can pass all of them because he's driving a Mercedes. That is fast, mami. That is fast. Nobody church a lay and never so who soul at one. But he says it over, and before I know it, because he has praised me enough that I cannot disappoint him. I'm going to get that thing on that pedal. Because he was talking my ego. Then I decided so that I don't disappoint my son. How much more will your God put his foot on the pedal when you praise him? My God shall deliver me from all evil. My God shall never fail. In his own people. So, even our children, the more they praise you, the more you'll give to them, because praise does that for you. It's the same thing to their kings. When you come in the presence of the king, and this is important, I want you to listen to me now, because this is the message I want to preach now. Kings have praise singers, people who sing for them. Those of you that lived many years ago with me during the Kaunda days, when he comes, the political slogans were Kumulu, Farsi, Kumulu, Unip. Normally, she can only give a Kumulu, yes, I know it's terrible. It sounds terrible. But the more they praise Kaunda, Liza from Kukakuni, because all of a sudden, put a promoter of a once a better promotion, because you have touched the spot. Any king that can be praised will always give out.
Yeah.
Now, allow me to say this. I say this by the Spirit of God. I know that the revival that is remaining now to happen will start from Africa.
Yeah.
Why? Because the way we are configured in Africa, we are configured with respect. We respect honor. That's when we are not coming. That disposition we have, which we teach our children, is not all over the world. It's on the African continent. In Africa, we actually worship authority. That's why politicians in Africa can take advantage of you, because they know even when they are wrong, when they come, but now we show kutila ichalana chomaika. But because to alichindika, you know, I was invited to Swaziland again when I was in government to represent President Mwanawasa at a summit meeting. Now Swaziland has a king, King Mswati. That's where you see how Africans honor their kings. Chao mungu pa wesu. Natule pitasona wa Mswati, wonse wale wa panshi. Baye te kose. Baye te kose. Baye te kose. And all the way through to the arena, they were all falling on the ground. It's and people, Americans, think we are stupid. Ala fitawari wa stupid. No. We are royalty. We understand royalty. We understand authority.
Yes.
We understand God. Oh God, I thank you, God. I praise you in the name of Jesus. Oh Jesus, come down and heal us. He's gonna come.
Yes,
humility before God is the key to touching the heart of God.
Yes,
Africans, do not be embarrassed to show holiness, honor, and praise to God. But the nation will vote for government. If you can't kneel before your father, then you cannot kneel before your heavenly father.
Yeah.
The reason we teach you to do that is so that it can become natural for you to honor authority. God resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Did you hear that? The Lord resists the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. Now, I've been in politics long enough, 24 years now. And I know that in politics, protocol and authority is important. Issues of pride. Issues of not knowing authority. In politics, I've got my officials there. If they are saying there's a meeting and I miss to introduce one using the right title, the Ikiashinda. Akopenda ine na afamu mliipate. Kwa tabu mchinjio. Nishina ushasis vice district secretary. Ukurandati. Now I'm going to introduce the vice district secretary to come and greet the people. Now I'm going to talk after the crisis. Because politicians know authority and the levels. That's why they are ruling you. That's why a lot of church people cannot get into leadership. You know, when you call as cadre, let me now tell you something that is really not supposed to be talked about in church. Have you heard those cadres? There's a minister in Lusaka who keeps saying, calling my president Lungu, the great leader. No. He knows that each king has an ego. And if he wants to be promoted, he must clutch it. If he doesn't die, I'm going to get promoted. I can't even let you look at your feet. In another shoe, me, my no is no. Yes, it's yes. No one can bend me. Okay. It's okay. But it means you'll be not bent in the same position until you die. Now, that is something very, very different that I'm teaching you today. If you are very proud, who my boss says you're, David humbled himself before a totally ungodly king. So, why did he honor him? He goes there, he finds him in the cave, passing water, and he cuts part of his garment and runs away without killing him. And yet the king was looking for David. But David goes and cuts a piece. And then goes on the mountain and says, look, my Lord, I repent for having cut this from you. Forgive me. But if I wanted to kill you, I would have killed you. But you are the Lord's anointed. I can't touch you. Joseph served an Egyptian God and a king. Somebody who didn't even believe in his God. But he humbled himself until he was given the whole kingdom. Why? He didn't go there for like Fatine, the Hebrew. I'm a Pentecostal. I don't do any of that stuff. He humbled himself not to the devil, but to authority.
Yeah.
I want to say this to you, that if you want to get anything in your life, you have to learn the subject of humility.
Yeah.
God has made us in his image to the extent that if we stroke his image, we stroke his image, God will react and respond according to what you have done. And I say this, even in the church, I want to go back to the church. The respect we have in the church. In fact, let me not say the church, because the church in Nigeria or West Africa is very different from the church in Tamil.
Yeah, yeah.
Look at me, everybody.
Yeah.
The church in West Africa is very different from the church in Central Africa. What is the difference? In West Africa, they respect the leaders. To the extent that God begins to bless them. But here, our poverty comes from the fact that we are so stubborn and we think that we are the bosses ourselves and the pastors are the same as us. I know all of you, new pastors, the reason why people don't honor you is that you don't honor those above you. So why do you want others to honor you when you don't honor those above you? Once in a while, just buy a gift for somebody who is a minister of the gospel. I say, listen, I think you have done enough for the kingdom. I just want to thank you. Humility is the gateway to what God has for you. Now listen before I conclude. What happens when you praise God is what I wanted to talk about. How does God respond to praise? In Matthew 20, 34, when they called on Jesus, the blind man said, Jesus, thou son of David. The Bible says Jesus stood still because of praise and made him whole. In 2 Chronicles 25-7, Jehoshaphat won a war through praise. When the sons of Judah began to praise God in a war, all of a sudden, the Bible says, the more they praise God, the enemy began to kill themselves. You have enemies in your life. If you want them to be defeated and you praise God, they begin to kill each other. I've got example after example. Praise means you put God where he belongs. You honor him. That's why I'm here today. I'm doing politics, but I want you to know that my strength comes from honoring God. Wherever I'm going in politics will come from God, not from man. And I want you to know today that the reason I have taught on this subject is for us to understand that the ego thing we feel as human beings comes from God, because we are created in the image of God. And if you scratch that ego, your hands become weak and you start to provide, even if you're a husband. I'll never forget, many years ago when I started crusades as a young evangelist. Now this is for you pastors. All of you pastors, I want you to hear this. When I started having crusades as a young man, there's something I found out. People started to say, Nevers has healing powers. But when I went to sleep, I knew where the powers was coming from. I trained my team, the Jeston Katelis, those of you that remember my first team. I trained them that when we go to a crusade, what is important is to make sure that God comes down. Listen to that. It is possible, So I said to my team, I can't heal anybody. And so if we don't bring God in the house, then nothing is going to happen. So in Mufulira, one of my first crusades, I had just been teaching my team about that. Then Jeston got the microphone, Pastor Jeston Katebo, some of you know him. He was my first youth pastor, crusade worship leader. He began to lead the congregation in worship. And I gave him songs to sing. Songs that just glorify who God is. That without him, nothing would have been. It is because of him that we even walk and breathe. It's because of him that we are who we are. It's because of him that we're going to make it. The moment you exalt him, ukumulungu lefyawa, chimono kutira, apana pekara, Pastor Darius. Everyone, because of Darius, Darius. But I'm going to touch you for the first 3 times. The fourth time, I said, hey! Every 3 or 4 is such today. The more we call you, that's all we want from God. Because we know how to call him. A church without God is a useless assembly of dying humans.
Oh, yeah.
Why do you come if you don't want God in the house? So Jeston began to lead in worship. Something began to happen. That's the first time in my young evangelistic life I felt the anointing in a way I had never felt. I had not preached a word. Worship was so deep. And the musician, the organist that I had, John Mulenda, up to this day I believe he has been the most anointed Zambia has ever produced. He's late now. But when he never went to school that much, he couldn't read music, but when he sat in front of the organ, it's like the organ is speaking praises to God. Jeston lifts up the microphone. The power of God begins to flow. Jeston begins to tremble because now the presence is so strong. John remains as the only one playing. All the musicians, the guitarists fell backwards. They stopped playing the music. The only one who remained playing was John. And that sound, I still hear it today. As it called on God's presence in a way that I've never heard before. Jeston was crying with the microphone until he began to shake to look for the preacher, because I told them, don't give me the microphone to preach until his presence is in the house. That was his assignment. Don't you just say hallelujah, bring him down. So that when I speak by the anointing. And when he wanted now with tears in eyes to turn around and give me the microphone, the preacher was on the floor crying, weeping, because I couldn't get up. I couldn't touch the microphone. The glory was in the house. Just on held on for a while until the microphone was thrown out of his hands by some supernatural power, and he fell on his face. Everybody began to fall on their faces. And then I started to hear something that changed my life. I started to hear cries from the people responding to Jesus without anybody making an altar call. They began to come to the front. Then I heard someone says, "I can walk! I can walk!" In Hindu hall, for him, nobody preached. They began to walk. Somebody said, "I can see! Oh my God, I couldn't see before!" And I was knocked out. Nobody was preaching. But the glory had come down. Because we had scratched the ego of God. When you scratch his ego and he comes down, pastors, change is complicated when you want to do it on your own.
Yes.
Invite him. Your job will be easier. You preach shorter and God will do more. But you must humble yourself. That's the vision I have for victory. The vision I have for victory is that you people need to learn to allow the Holy Spirit. In fact, you don't even have to be a good preacher if the Holy Spirit is there. You don't even have to be a good preacher if the Holy Spirit is there. And therefore today I submit to you, in my power, I can give you nothing. But with God's power, he can give you everything. And that is what I want to say for Zambia. If Zambia is going to change, we must allow the power of God to move upon this nation. What we're going to do in the next few minutes is that I am going to ask you to bring anything broken to the altar. A broken heart, a broken family, a broken relationship, an ability where you cannot get married, a situation that has devastated you. It's complicated, you can't solve it. I want you to bring it to the altar. I don't want you to bring to the altar those things you can fix yourself. I just want those things you cannot fix. I want you to bring them here. And then we want to surround them with his presence and with his glory. As we start to minister to him, I believe God is going to show you things he has not shown you before.
Oh, yeah.
So tonight, today, I want to invite you. And I also want to bring Zambia here in its broken state. That as we now minister to the Lord, healing may start to flow through our land. His presence is what makes the difference. His presence is what church is all about. I hunger for his anointing. I hunger for his presence. I hunger for the anointing of God more than anything else. Thank God for what he has given me. Thank God for my wife. Thank God for my 5 children. Thank God for the house I live in. Thank God for raising me in this nation as a leader at different levels to the level of vice president. I don't know where else I'm going to go. But I thank him. But beyond all that, all I want more than any of that is his presence. If your presence can go with us, if your presence can go with us, it shall be worth it. And that's what I'm calling you to do. Call on his presence. Walk with God. Because if you do, no weapon that is formed against you shall prosper. God will fight for you. Don't hunger just for food. Don't hunger just for things. Hunger for his presence. Hunger for his presence. When somebody begins to hunger for God, Zambia will become the example of this continent. Because there's nothing that God is going to hold back from us. I don't come to church to impress somebody. I come here because I want him. I want him in my life. Because when he's in my life, no weapon that is formed against me shall prosper. What I cannot do, you can do. Where I cannot reach, you can take me. A job I'm not qualified for, you can give me. We need your presence. Come, Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, and fill this sanctuary. Come, Holy Spirit, in the way that only you know how. We honor you because you are God. We honor you because beside you there is no other God. We honor you because you created the heavens and the earth. And every knee shall bow. And every tongue shall confess that Jesus, you are Lord. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We glorify your name. Heal this nation. Heal Zambia. Heal this land. Forgive us as a nation. Let your glory fill this house. I want the choir to begin to walk to the front while Chris prepares to come and join me. But I want us to call him. He's the one who knows what we are going through. He's the one who knows the pain you feel. But I can't do anything for you except he comes himself. Come, Holy Spirit. We need you. Come, sweet Spirit, we pray. Come, Holy Spirit. We need you. We need you, Abba Zambia, to be saved. We can't solve the problems of Zambia by just new policies. But when you come down in the midst of us, you shall heal our land. You save my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves and pray. Seek my face, turn away from their wicked ways. I'll hear them from heaven. I will forgive their sin and heal their land. Come, Holy Spirit. We need you. We need you. We need you. Zambia needs you. Our homes need you. These lives need you. Holy Spirit of God. Where's Chris? We need you. We need you, give him his own back if it's possible. We need you, Holy Ghost. Stand to your feet, lift those hands, and let him know that we hunger for his presence. We hunger for his presence. We shall sing song of worship and call on his name. And Chris, you just go ahead and obey the Lord as he leads you today. I feel his presence.
Spirit, 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 Holy Spirit, Thank you.
God wants to answer your prayers. But I want you to listen to me. God wants to answer your prayers. But God is showing me that a lot of you don't know what you want. You first have to have a conversation with yourself. Convince yourself what you want from God. Then once you know what you want, then bring it to God. You can't come to the front wanting everything on earth. Focus is the word God gave me a few minutes ago. Focus on one thing you want today. Focus on it. So that when God is answering you, He will answer you by what you're presenting to Him. The Bible says you have not because you ask not. And because you ask amiss. Some of you are just Christians, general Christians. You don't even remember anything God ever answered you about because you are not even clear in your minds. I had to deal with that myself. When God asked me, never, what do you want me to do? I said, Lord, I want to take my faith. I want values of equality and justice and the love we preach in the church. I want it to be taken in politics so that politics can be influenced by the values of Christianity. I was clear and unclear about that. Some of you say, I'm doing two things, but I'm asking God to bring my faith into this arena where there's no faith. That's my only prayer to God. Because after that, someday shall be saved long after I'm gone. And our children will benefit from those godly values. And if your prayer request will touch more than you, God will give it to you. And I want you to be specific. And when you have anything specific as we worship, when you come to know what you want from God, and I want you to walk from where you are and come to the front. Only when you know what you want from God. When you do, then you start to walk to the front. We are going to give Him praise. Call Him who He is as people start to walk to the front before I pray. But before you come here, you've got to know what you want. Because if you don't know, your walk to the front will be a waste of time. So once you know, I invite you to come. Chris, bring us into His presence.
Carry the bomb with